Welcome to this service at Faith and Victory Church. This is the place to come to receive your miracle from God. Now, let's join our service already in progress.
Let's go ahead, if you will. Let's do a quick review while Jesse gets us connected somehow, some way. Hallelujah. All right. We're in Healings of the Ministry of Jesus, part 5. Hallelujah. Amen. And we are talking about there are 30-plus recorded healings in the ministry of Jesus. There are 19 different healings. Now, reason for that, we know what's the reason for this? It's because there's 19 different ones and there's 30 recorded because there are multiple accounts in the different Gospels. In other words, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John may record the same healing each one. Or I think there's a couple of times all of them do it. Most of the time it's Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And then John would be different, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So we have 30 plus recorded, 19 are different. 12, the individual's faith is given credit. The 7 others, we have gifts of the Spirit, a sovereign move of God, like the troubling of the water, and along those lines. So we have these are the different things that we are encountering. No connection, huh? All right. Okay. We are talking about healing as a redemptive truth. It is a redemptive truth. Yahweh or YHWH being the what? What is this? This is the distinctive what of God? Distinctive covenant name. Distinctive covenant name of God. The hyphenated names, of which there are 7, are, as Scofield says, an increasing self-revelation of who God is in his covenant. Okay? First of all, he said he's the Lord. He's the God of the covenant. Then he said, I am the Lord Rapha. I am the Lord thy physician. I am the Lord that heals thee. Okay? So we have here the redemptive truth, the YHWH. Your King James Bible and some other translations will have that in what we call small caps, all little capital letters, the word Lord spelled that way. It comes from these 4 letters, YHWH. We added vowels, so we have Yahweh. One school of thought says Yahweh. Another says Jehovah. They are the same word in the Hebrew. They come from the exact same place. There's nothing different about them. Not, one's not more spiritual than the other. One's not more accurate than the other. It was just a school of thought of the ones who were translating or trying to make it pronounceable. This name is unpronounceable. They believe that historically that the scribes got, because it was so holy, they would get up and wash themselves when they wrote this. It was so holy, they felt like they had to go wash and cleanse themselves before they could translate that word. And they refused to pronounce it, ultimately lost how to pronounce it, it became the unpronounceable name of God. Okay? All right, so we have the redemptive, the covenant name of God, the distinctive covenant name of God, YHWH, Yahweh or Jehovah, Jehovah, and then hyphenated, and God does that 7 times, Jehovah Rapha, Jehovah Tsidkenu, Jehovah Shalom, Jehovah Shammah, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Imkadesh. We have those different 7 names, and they all are an increasing self-revelation of God. The very first one that God gave, the first name that God gave in an increasing self-revelation of himself besides the God of the covenant was the God of the covenant who heals you. Okay, so we end up with YHWH Rapha. Please tell me you're online. No. You're on. Are you not on? Is that plug not working? Is the switch on the power strip? So you're not getting anything, right, Jesse?
Right. I mean, I'm connected, and now I'm not connected
to the camera. Unplug the audio. See what happens. Aggravation.
Is it? Network thing. It's internet.
So. All right. And you can't go on out there.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have any data left? How long would it take to download the app? God knows. All right. Okay. Well, let's make sure we get it, Carrie. All right. Okay. The distinctive covenant name of God in the very first one is the Lord, the God of the covenant, the Lord of the covenant, who keeps his covenant, is your healer. So we have the God who keeps his covenant is your healer. So we end up with the distinctive covenant name of God. This is Lord, the God who keeps his covenant. He is the distinctive God of the covenant, and he is your healer. Okay? He is the distinctive name of God. He is your healer. All right. So now we've gone from there. We've gone into the healings and the ministry of Jesus. We're in part five. We've covered, we've covered 13 of them. So we're down to number 14. Let's get a different color so we can just make this distinctive here. We're on number 14, and this is the man born blind. Find this story in John's Gospel, the 9th chapter, 1 through the end of the chapter, which is 30, the whole chapter, through chapter 1. So it's the whole chapter. Okay? So the man born blind, chapter 9, verse 1 through 41. Let's look here. We won't read the entire chapter. There's a lot in this, but some of the things we'll come back to. Okay? And Jesus passed by and saw a man which was blind from his birth. And the disciples asked him, saying, Master, who did sin, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Now, the Jews believed that if you had sickness, you had done something to cause it. In other words, sickness was the Jewish belief was that if you were sick, you had sinned. Okay? But he was born blind. So could he sin in the womb? Or was it a result of his parents' sin? So they wanted to know, they were in a dichotomy there, because they were thinking, well, he's in the womb, how could he have sinned? So who did sin, his parents or him? Now Jesus answers and says this. He says, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but that the works of God should be made manifest in him. Now we read that traditionally in a way that may be inaccurate. We go, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents, but or so that, or because God made him blind so he could work out a miracle in him. That's how we read that most of the time. That's the import we take. And so let's go ahead and read some more. But that the works of God should be made manifest to him. I must work the works of him that sent me. While it is day, the night cometh, and no man can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. When he had thus spoken, he spat on the ground, there's that spitting again, and made clay of the spittle, and anointed his eyes of the blind man with the clay. He said, go wash in the pool of Siloam, which is by interpretation sent. He went his way therefore, washed, and came seeing. Now here we go. So really, the main import of this story is found in verses 1 through 7. Okay, that's the main part of this story, and our account. And so we have the disciples wanting to know, who sinned? Somebody had to sin because this guy was born this way. And I got a hard time believing that he could do that in the womb, so maybe his parents sinned. Jesus' response is neither. Is that right? All right. Okay. Neither. Now, he says, neither hath this man sinned nor his parents. Now, we got a semicolon there. The word here, and let's come over here. This word, but. All right, he says, but we got neither this man sinned nor his parents, semicolon, then but. KJ uses the word but. This is the Greek A-L-L-A, okay? And I guess we pronounce that, depending on where, how you pronounce Allah, not Allah like the Hebrew Muslim name for God, but Allah or Allah. And this is the Greek. Okay, this word means but, yet, rather, or nevertheless. This is how it's translated in the New Testament, these four words. So we get but, yet, rather, nevertheless, okay? From the Greek word here that's translated, that we have in the King James, we have the word but here. Let me submit this to you. Jesus answered the question, neither this man sinned nor his parents. Now, sickness is in the world because of the fall of man. There, people are susceptible to disease because of the fall of man. Because a cold comes to you and you're fighting and battling a cold and you're believing God to be healed or doing whatever, does not mean you sinned. In the sense that it's a direct result of a sin you committed is why you're sick. Okay? No. We're living in a fallen world. Fallen world has made us susceptible to different things. We use our faith in God and faith in God's word. We believe God and we fight the things of this world to be victorious and overcome. But it doesn't mean because you woke up this morning and, you know, you woke up and you feel like a Mack truck backed over you and you're sitting there struggling because that thing's sitting on top of you and taking the life out of you and you're going, oh my God. Okay? All right? That you sinned yesterday or the day before and cause it to happen. That's not, see, but that was the correlation the Jews were making. They were making the correlation that if you were sick, you had sinned. Jesus comes back and just says, neither one did. In the sense, now we all know what? All have sinned. Okay? That wasn't what he was saying. Okay? We know that. We know this. We know all of sin comes short of the glory of God. When Jesus said neither his parents sinned or this man sinned, he was making reference to it being the cause of this, him being blind. It wasn't that they had, it was a direct relationship to a particular sin they had committed. All sin and come short of the glory of God. And because of that, Adam did, and because of that, it's in the world. And because it's in the world, then we are susceptible to things. We all are susceptible. That's a negative confession. Don't be stupid. Understanding what you're dealing with is how you win against it. I wouldn't say that. No, we all became susceptible. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. If you weren't susceptible, you wouldn't need to overcome. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. If you didn't have anything to overcome, you wouldn't need the faith. So let's not be stupid or crazy with confession statements that are not biblically based. I'm not susceptible. Nope. Now, I'll say no plague comes nigh my dwelling because I ward it off with the word of God. I say what the word says. Don't just say something because it sounds like you might be in faith. Because some people probably aren't. Okay? All right. So, Jesus comes there. We read it in verse 3. Neither this man sinned nor his parents. He has a colon. But that the works of God may be manifest to him. I must work the works of him that sent me. Now, let's take that and say, nevertheless, which is where it's translated, nevertheless. Nevertheless, I'm the works of God may be manifest in him. I must work the works of him that sent me. Literally, the Greek says, we must work the works of him that sent me. Okay? So, Jesus is not saying, see, here's how we read it. I grew up in a church that believed, you know, we would stand in front of the church and join the church and say, I believe in divine healing as in the atonement, which is no such thing for the new church. We are redeemed. We're not atoned for. And then turn right around and say, and God made him sick, made the man born blind so he could work a miracle in him. And I always tell people, okay, let's take your thought. He was born blind, and guess what? He got healed. God worked a miracle in him. Not some unknown, you can't figure out what God's going to do. You have no idea what God's there doing. God demonstrates grace and mercy in that situation, even if he were born blind because God made him blind so he could work a miracle in him. He got healed. The people who go this other route never get healed. I don't know why God did this to me. You know? Anyway, okay. So really, let's take this word because it's translated but, yet, rather, or nevertheless. And it fits better in this thought, in this passage, when we read it that way. He says, neither this man has sinned nor his parents, nevertheless. that the works of God should be made manifest to him, I must work the works of him that sent me while it is day. Okay? God wants to work his work in him. And when, like I said, Jesus, that word we, I must work, really better in the Greek is we must work the works of him that sent me. I'm doing the work, but you're going to be doing the same works and greater works than these because I go to the Father. Amen? And so we take that and we kind of goes here. So now all of a sudden we can't kind of take the import of this scripture and change it, not rewriting the word, but change it from a theological perspective that says God made him blind so he could work a miracle, and more to, I'm answering your question, guys. Here's your belief. The sick, somebody sinned. Neither one did. All right? In other words, neither sinned, neither parent nor that man born caused him to be blind. Their actions didn't cause that. We've all sinned. Yes, we get that. We're in a fallen world, and the fallen world made that thing happen. Okay? So, when he says, but, he's really saying, nevertheless, that the works of God may be manifest to him, we must work the works of him that sent me. See? By putting the punctuation in the way they did, it gave it, and you got to understand, sometimes they would put punctuation in just because that's how they believed. You know? They didn't change the words, but the punctuation just changed the meaning. Okay? And when you understand that, you know, he got healed, he gets healed, but it can mean nevertheless, rather, or yet. So if you change any of these words, take but out, it'll change how you see that verse. Yet? That the works of God may be manifest in him, I must work the works of him that sent me. Rather, that the word of God, that the works of God be made manifest, I must work the works. Nevertheless, what? Whether he sinned or his parents is irrelevant. We're here to work the works of the one that sent me. Amen. Y'all got that? Y'all with me here? Lose anybody? Okay. So we must work the works. Nevertheless, we must work the works of him that sent me. Okay? So, what is that? Well, what did Jesus do? Go out in the villages doing? Preaching, teaching, and what? Isn't that right? He preached, taught, and healed. Isn't that right? What did he tell the disciples to go? Going all over and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth is baptized. Shall we say he believeth not? So they're to preach. Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever. So teach. And then what do you say? You'll lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. Heal. This is the commission of the church. This was the commission of Jesus. This is the works that we are to work. Preach, teach, and heal. So Jesus is saying basically here, he's coming back going, hey guys, it's not really relevant. Parents didn't sin, he did. That's not why he's sick. We got to work the works of the one that sent me. He sent me to heal. The Son of Righteousness shall arise with healing in his wings. Healing is the children's bread. Bless the Lord, O my soul, all that's within me, forget, and bless his holy name, forget not all of his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases. Amen. So now we have Jesus taking a question, because those disciples are going, no, Lord, I don't get it. You know, I mean, he was born that way. You know, well, I can't say. Well, when he was five, he shot a dove out of a tree with a slingshot and killed it, and so he's blind because of that. We don't have anything we can go back to. So maybe we can go back to the parents. Nope, neither one. Nevertheless, he's blind. We must work the works of him that sent me. That the works of God may be manifest. That particular phrase should normally be translated manifested, but it's the ART subjective form of the verb, meaning if you're in a future event. Okay, that the works of God may be manifested in him or become manifest in him. We must work the works. And then Jesus spits on the ground. That spitting ministry again. Rubs in his eyes, so go wash in the pool of Siloam. He goes and comes again seeing. Okay, so this is not a faith event, is it? This comes under the category of an other. It comes under a, did I have that up here? Oh, yeah, other. Comes up under The gifts are sovereign, etc. Okay? And we know it's a gift because he's making spit again. That's a sign and a wonder. Amen? I mean, you get healed. I mean, listen, last thing you want in your eyeballs when they're hurt is clay or dirt. I don't care if it's spittle, clay, or what. It's still grainy. Go wash that out in the pool. You'll come again seeing. Okay. So we have the man born blind. And it wouldn't hurt you to read this whole chapter, okay, and see about this. There's just other things there, you know. It was the Sabbath day, and the religious folks got ticked off and all that kind of stuff. Furious. Can we say furious? They were livid. Kind of like what's going on in America right now. Oh, my goodness. I know a whole bunch of people who did not like the previous president being elected. I didn't see them protesting, bombing places, burning cars down, knocking out windows, rioting. I mean, you know, getting on the internet and threatening assassination and all this kind of stuff. I mean, it's happening all over the place. I mean, just, you know, not showing up for committee meetings to confirm the cabinet so the country can't run, so he can look bad, so that they can, you know, trying to get him impeached. He hadn't even been in office a month. Yeah, I mean, it's lunacy out there, okay? And they've gone stark, raving, nutbag crazy. Hallelujah. Well, the Pharisees went stark, raving, nutbag crazy. They didn't care this guy was healed. Let me say something. Jesus said one time, somebody said, you know not what spirit you're of. Remember when James and John came to him and said, shall we call fire down out of heaven on them? They were the sons of Zebedee. You know what that means? The word Zebedee meant thunder. They were the sons of thunder. Those guys were roughhousers. I mean, they were not your gentle spirited guys. They were roughhouse. You know, they were fishers. They were just rough. I mean, they were the rough part of town. They even got nicknamed called the Sons of Thunder, you know? And so when they didn't like the way they got received in one place, so we called fire down out of heaven. Well, they're ready to cook somebody. And Jesus said, you know not what spirit you're of. And they probably went. And Peter must not have been there. He missed that meeting. He's cutting guys' ears off, cussing and all kinds of stuff, even at the very end. Hallelujah. All right. So, it's good to read this. Jesus rebukes them, and this guy just, you know, they go on and on. They're investigating the parents. They're investigating the man. They want to know who did this. Who had the audacity to heal somebody on a Sabbath day? You hypocrite. Okay. Let's look again now. Let's look at the 16th healing. Okay. Wow. I said 14. This is really 15. I apologize. This is 15. This is number 15. 16. Crippled woman. Huh. We find this located in Luke's Gospel, chapter 13. This is found in Luke 13, verses 10. 21. So we have the crippled woman, Luke's Gospel, chapter 13, verses 10 through 21. All right. And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. And behold, there was a woman which had a spirit of infirmity 18 years and was bound together and could in no wise lift herself up. Now, this woman has been here how long? 18 years. She's been in this condition 18 years. All right? And when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and said, woman, thou art loosed from thine infirmity. And he laid his hands on her, and immediately she was made straight and glorified God. And the ruler of the synagogue answered with indignation because that Jesus had healed on the Sabbath day. And said to the people, there are 6 days in which men ought to work, and then therefore come and be healed, not on the Sabbath day. Now let me ask you something. In these 18 years, and those 6 days a week, What was Leroy doing? The ruler of the synagogue. Why was she still this way after 18 years when she had 6 days a week? He could come, he could do a work and get her healed. His power was threatened. Okay? The ruler did nothing. In 18 years, he didn't do anything. 18 years, this woman was bent over. 18 years, she suffered. 18 years, she has no liberty. And the ruler did nothing. But Jesus shows up, walks in, sees her, calls her up, and says, "You are loosed." And the ruler gets ticked off. Because she got healed, what? On the Sabbath. He was more concerned about the Sabbath than he was about her being crippled. He was more concerned about his religious laws than he was about this woman being crippled for 18 years. You hear, you're going home. So Jesus answered and said, "You're right. Shouldn't have done that on the Sabbath. That was a bad choice on my part. What was I thinking? I was, thinking that she'd been 18 years and, she had been suffering and I had compassion on her, but forgive me for doing it on the Sabbath because we know that's more important than anything on the planet." Now, Jesus goes, "Thou hypocrite, doth not each one of you on the Sabbath loose his ox or his ass from the stall and lead him away to watering? And ought not this woman," here we go, verse 16, "being a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan hath bound." Verse 16. A daughter What's this referring to? Covenant. The daughter of, she's the daughter of Abraham. She's got a covenant right to access YHWH Rapha, Yahweh Rapha, Jehovah Rapha. She has a covenant right to this. She's the daughter of Abraham. She is in covenant relationship with God. And because she is the daughter of Abraham, she is in covenant with YHWH Rapha. And just to make it clear, whom Satan hath bound. God wasn't doing it. Satan did it. Hello? The ruler of the synagogue would rather side in with Satan's binding of the woman because it's the Sabbath rather than let a daughter of Abraham who has a covenant with Yahweh Rapha experience what he has for her and being loose from her spirit of infirmity that she suffered with 18 years. Amen? More concerned with that than anything. And so Jesus rebukes him. And when he said these things, all the adversaries were ashamed. And the people rejoiced for all the glorious things that were done by him. Then he said, what is the kingdom like? I'll resemble it. It's a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and cast into the garden, grew, waxed great tree. The fowls of there came and lodged in the branches thereof. Wherefore shall I liken the kingdom of God? It's like leaven, which a woman took and hid 3 measures of the meal till the whole was leavened. Okay, kind of aside from this story. Jesus makes it clear she's a covenant woman. It was Satan that had her bound. She had a right to the Lord, her physician. And if you care more about your donkey than you do God's covenant people, there's a problem with you. Hello? There are 6 days in which the donkey ought to eat, and not on the Sabbath. Or if he falls into a ditch, he'll just have to wait till the next day to get out. No, there's a livelihood there. There's beast of burden there. There's issues there that they need that animal. You know, it's inhumane to leave it there. And listen, have things changed? Not a bit. They care more about people having the ethical treatment of animals more than they do about babies being born. Yeah, they're more concerned about animals than they are about humans.
Yes.
All right, so things haven't changed. What, it's the same devil?
Uh-huh.
I said it's the same devil in operation. It's an ant. What? Because humanity was created in what? The likeness and image of God. Satan hates it. Paul wrote to the Church of Rome, said they worship the creature rather than the creator.
Yeah.
So you call yourself a liberal Christian and all this mess, and just look who you're aligning yourself with. The crowd who worships the creature rather than the creator. You've got the wisdom of this world, which is earthly, sensual, and devilish. Aligning yourself with people who kill babies. And call yourself a liberal Christian. No, you're operating under the spirit of the devil. You're operating under the spirit of Antichrist. You're operating under a demonic spirit. And I don't really care. I'll tell you to your face. And I got Bible to back it up. You ain't got doodly squat. Except how ye feel. And your little ribbon you wear. I care more because I have more ribbons. No, I care more because I'm here to give you the truth. And why? Because the truth will set you free. The ribbon won't do a thing for you. The truth will set you free.
Amen.
Amen. I said the truth will set you free. The ribbon won't do doodly squat for you. Except make you feel like you've accomplished something in life because you've gone out and wore a ribbon. And your kitty cat hat. Oh, gosh. It's amazing. That March for Women care about all the women in the world except the ones who believed in abortion. Against abortion. Who were against abortion. They weren't allowed to join them.
Oh.
I thought you cared about women. Not women who disagree with us. Uh-huh. The tolerant crowd demonstrated their tolerance again. Yeah. Hallelujah. All right. So, I don't think we're going to get any further tonight because we've got the man with the dropsy, the 10 lepers, and the blind men near Jericho. Okay? Really blind Bartimaeus. There's one story has two of them there. The other counts have just blind Bartimaeus. So, we're here in Healings Part 5. What? We got the man born blind. Okay? This is another. The crippled woman is another. That's a manifestation of a gift of the Spirit. Jesus just called her up and as far as we know, she didn't exercise any faith. He was just saying she had a right to it. She just had it flat. I had a right to it. It belonged to her. Okay? All right. Anybody have any questions?
We trust that you were blessed by the Word of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in this service. If you would like to contact us, please write us via email at office@fvc.org or using our mailing address, P.O. Box 7752, Greensboro, North Carolina 27417. If you would like to contribute to our ministry, please go to our website at www.fvc.org and click on the Giving Online button. Thank you, and may God richly bless you for your giving.